to our city commission meeting. We're going to open with a prayer from Pastor Scott Roberts of the First Church of Nazarene, followed by the pledge led by General Queen. Please rise.
Let's pray. Father, here we are again, and we say thank you for another service we can provide for the city of Panama City. Thank you for the blessing of these that have given their lives this way and all the audience here that have come to share in this moment. We pray that your Holy Spirit would infuse us with wisdom and grace and such a deep sense of togetherness, Lord, that nothing could possibly keep your will from being done. And I pray your blessing upon us all now in Jesus' name. Amen.
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 Please join me in the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Ms. Waldron, would you call the roll, please, ma'am?
Mayor Brodnicki.
Here.
Commissioner Halagus.
Here.
Commissioner Brown.
Here.
Commissioner Rader.
Here.
Commissioner Nichols.
Here.
Got the minutes from the August 25th meeting. Then when I had a chance to read those minutes ahead of time, any additions, deletions, changes that you think need to be made, so save this time, or entertain a motion to approve the minutes as presented.
Mr. Mayor, I would like to move approval of the City Commission meeting minutes from August 25, 2020.
Second motion, Mayor.
Call the roll.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brodnicki?
Yes. Is there any changes to the agenda? Anything that anyone?
Yes, there is, Mr. Mayor, on my part. Items 8B is in boy, 8C is in cat, and 8D as in dog. I'd like to, at the request of the applicant, Southern Cat, like to make a motion that it be delayed until the first meeting in October. I believe that's right. The second meeting in October, Mr. McQueen? The date again? Excuse me, 20th of October. We had.
Billy's like, are you sure?
27 October. 27 October. Anyway, this company is in they're in Louisiana working on Hurricane Laura, and they do restoration and mold removal, and we can all relate to what they're going through. And so they could not have any representation here today. So they have politely asked if we could delay that item. So I'd like to ask if we could do that.
Okay. There's a motion to delay 8, B, C, and D till October 27th.
Thank you.
Do I hear a second?
Second the motion.
Any discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brodnicki?
Yes.
Thank you, Mayor.
This time we'll have audience participation. If there's something that you would like to bring up to the commission that is not on the agenda tonight, do so at this time. State your name and address.
You can speak, sir. Yeah. As soon as he's finished, you can. Yes.
James Hayden, 1612 Fortune Avenue, here in Panama City. I'd like to let the city know that we appreciate what you're doing out at Hillside Cemetery. It's really an improvement. But we also would like to let you know that there are people on the east side of the cemetery that are still building and putting in big gates out there so they could drive through the cemetery to get to their property. Also, I would like to let it be known that eventually we're going to have to shut down some of those roads to make for burial ground. Wouldn't want to cause them any extra expenses if they can be stopped putting the gates in now.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. We'll work on that. Thank you.
Thank you, Sergeant Major. Mr. Mayor and Commissioners, we have recently been approved for, by FEMA, for all four of our cemeteries to replace the damaged segments of the fencing. We've also put a lot of work into improving the grounds of each of the cemeteries to include Hillside. I appreciate Sergeant Major coming forward and sharing that information. Additionally, we are working to ask DOT that on the northern perimeter of the cemetery, that to see if there's any way that DOT, which is 23rd Street, would allow a small, narrow sidewalk along that northern boundary, because right now it's just a trail up there, and a lot of people are using that. So we want to try to do that. And then lastly, I've asked our Public Works Department to go out, and they have already completed it, the survey on the property, so we know exactly where, as requested, those fences are going to be erected to make sure it's on their side, and to make them aware that the expansion of the cemetery is about to happen.
Okay, very good.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
I've come to talk to y'all about the taxes that y'all are proposing, irregardless of the fire tax. I'm just going to, y'all went up 27% in 2019.
Yeah, we need your name and address, sir.
Oh, I'm sorry. Marvin Strickland, 1217 Blue Stem Street, Panama City, Florida. Okay. 32405.
Thank you.
Well, y'all went up 27% in 19. You went up 41% in the incoming year. Y'all are collecting within $65 of what the largest employer in Bay County gets as taxes. The school board's getting 917 for the coming year. Y'all are getting 852. That $65 differs from the Panama City and the entire school board budget. Something else I'd like to say, and this is going from Mr. McQueen, his letter that he wrote is in the News Herald on the 6th of September. He's talking about the money that the city was short. And the way I read this, y'all got a $5 million forgivable disaster loan from FEMA and $1.2 million from Triumph Funds. That leaves y'all $800,000 in the red for the last year. He also got on here that, and one thing I do agree with him about is that he wants to hire by $2.3 million worth of new equipment. The world I grew up in, when things was tight, you tied the purse strings. The only purse strings y'all are tightening around the citizens of Panama City's neck. Want more and more money every year. You got 46%, you want more. Then he wants to hire 10, 15 new people, plus additional positions, ever how many that is. You know, I can see if he wants to, you know, hire some, but times are hard, people are hard, people are not working, you know. So it ain't the time to just get on a Washington spending spree, you know. Then he wants to hire two more assistants for himself. I can see, I don't know all of what he does, but one at a time would be way plenty to me. If he needs more help than that, then he can get one of the secretaries to help him out.
Excuse me, let me just clarify. That was a misprint. So it was a misprint. It's only one. Go ahead.
Okay, that's about all I want to say about that. But I was going to say one thing I agree with his position here is to get away from the ad valorem taxes. You know, the best tax to me to charge anybody and get out the ad valorem things is a sales tax. We a tourist place, tourists pay it. Whatever you do, when you buy something in Panama City, you pay a tax on it. That's the easiest, simplest, less strenuous on the taxpayers. I know it's not instant money, but you put a penny, 2 cents, for 5 years, should be way plenty to take up the slack that y'all are needing and all this spending that y'all are planning on doing. And all that's basically, I'll be back on the 24th.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
So, Mayor, just real quick. So, just we're having the budget talks next. So, if anyone wants to talk about the budget, well, let's
understand,
wait until we get
understand.
There.
Understand. Okay. With the budget, we're going to be discussing the budget. Yeah. So, nothing else about the budget until we get to the budget. So is there anything else that you want to bring up before the commission? All right, then we'll go into the budget. The public hearing is for the discussion and adoption of the tentative millage rates and tentative budgets for the City of Panama City and the Panama City Downtown Improvement District for fiscal year 2021. This is to serve as the first public hearing under the TRIM Act.
So, Mr. Mayor and Commissioners, as we know in the state of Florida, there's no income tax, and that all governance that is done locally at the city or county level is based on the sales tax allocations based from the state. For the City of Panama City, we also have the merchant fee. We also have the benefit of the gasoline distribution as well as franchise fee distributions that are made from the various utilities. And then, of course, the other portion of that rests with property ownership as with regard to ad valorem. The intent of having no income tax was to put the preponderance of the burden on property owners to fund their local governance, whether it's municipality or county. With that in mind, the Florida statutes are very deliberate about the process for proceeding with an annual consideration toward any type of budget. It's a requirement that we have a balanced budget, and what we have are a number of unknowns, but we're making as reasonable assumptions to ensure that we're not putting an over undue burden on our community. The city is also, as we all know, is recovering from Hurricane Michael, and we all know, and the mayor has championed this with discussions last year with members of Congress as well as the administration concerning the need to relieve municipalities that have been impacted by a disaster from the burden of interest expense. Right now, the city has had to take out a line of credit of $75 million to be able to fund the removal of all of the debris that we've had. So far, the city, we've drawn down approximately $69 million toward that $75 million on the line of credit. The interest on that, just for everyone's recollection, is that that's approximately $1.8 million a year for interest expense. So, one of the recommendations that we have as we follow the Florida's guidelines on establishing the process for the first public hearing concerning the adoption of a millage rate is that we would have a consideration toward the rate that was discussed last month, which was 6.6201. There's also, as you've been pre-briefed in your packets, there are other options that are available. There's the option of anywhere between that, which is the ceiling, that is by law, that's the maximum it could be for this community, to anywhere down below that. And it's at your discretion to choose that to where it is, where you would choose it to be. Tonight's conversation is to, again, have a opportunity to establish what that ceiling will be. Again, currently it's proposed at 6.6201, but it's the current actual rate for the city is 5.5469. That's what it has been for the year of 2020. The rollback rate, in other words, what we've experienced in the city is approximately a 5% increase in the values of our property. Now, putting that in context, last year, the year immediately after the storm, we had over a 14% reduction in the aggregate values of the city. It necessitated us increasing the millage rate to that 5.5469. Most residents actually saw a decrease in their actual property taxes paid because the basis that they were being assessed against was reduced by the property appraiser's office. Having said that, the rollback rate for this year is 5.2385. And that is the rollback rate to derive the exact same income that we had last year for the City of Panama City. In other words, we would not be able to do any of the actions that you and the citizens of the city have asked me to explore on behalf of them to improve the outcome of the city. Lastly, the millage rate could be anywhere below that, and that is certainly at your discretion to consider. So at this time, it would be appropriate to have a conversation about what that maximum millage rate should be as we continue to move forward. It does not bind this commission to making it the final decision on what that millage rate will be. That will not be determined until the 21st of September at 5:01 p.m. in these chambers. So with that, I submit to you, you and the citizens of the city of Panama City have seen the budget, and I submit it for your consideration and your direction as to how to proceed.
You know, there's so many unknowns that we're faced with this commission sitting up here now. First of all, the amount of money that we're going to get from the state, the governor nor anybody in Tallahassee can tell us because they still haven't figured it out. So we've got that unknown. And of course, we've got the unknown about the fire assessment, which is something that the city is considering doing. I've had a lot of phone calls about it and discussion about it. And, you know, they're saying, why now? And I think if you put the fire assessment in perspective here, it's talking about $4.6 million coming into the city. The reason that we talked about it in the first place, because that would be a huge portion of our budget, if you're already paying property tax, believe it or not, you want the fire assessment. Because there are $800 million worth of property within the city that doesn't pay any property tax. That's 27% of the property within the city that pays nothing. So they would be burdened with a portion of that fire assessment to the tune of about $1.4 to $1.5 million. So if they pay that, that won't be on the backs of the people that are already paying tax. You got to put it all in perspective. And so I've explained that to a lot of different people, and they get it. Wow.
Well, I've never had that happen.
You got to pay your power bill, too. So,
oh Lord.
Anyway, it makes it tough for us because we're sitting here pondering over what kind of millage rate that we want to have, and we don't know whether or not we're going to do the fire assessment, and the discussion of that is going to be next Monday. Mm-hmm. It's before the final vote for the millage, but it's after this meeting. Yeah. So it makes it a little tough. We want to do what's right. We want to share the love and spread the tax as much as we can because, you know, there's a lot of things that we're trying to do as a city now that we've been hamstrung because of the hurricane. And we're going to be getting a lot more money in. And there are going to be a lot of avenues for us to be able to draw and get funds. But in the meantime, our goal, I think that the gentleman talked about it earlier, our goal is to drive our millage rate down and to have as much of the taxes that we garner from consumption. We're very, very fortunate here in the city of Panama City that we have a 1% merchant fee. Mm-hmm. And we have a lot of people that come in from outside of the city to shop in the city. And if we fix our infrastructure to the point where we have more retail coming into the city, we will have more people coming into the city. And by fixing the infrastructure and by having more retail coming into the city, values will go up, millage will go down. Consumption taxes will go up, and millage will go down. But it's a process. And it's one that, as the general spoke a minute ago, we had to go out to make sure that we could clean up and start the process $75 million. Now, the city's in good shape, or the bank would have said, we'll never give you $75 million. Okay?
Yeah.
And we do have to pay it back, but in the meantime, we're paying $3,000 a day, or whatever it is, in interest. Is that about right?
I think it was 100.
$1.8 million. Whatever that works out, it might be double that. But anyway, we're having to pay that interest, and we're hoping that Congress will see that this is a cost, just like picking up the debris is a cost, that we will get reimbursed that money. But in the meantime, we've got to run the city. And so I pass the gavel to whoever wants to be the next person to speak, but there's a lot of misconceptions out there of people not understanding exactly what we're going through now. So, Mike, you want to start?
Yeah. Mayor, thank you. You know, and based on the last couple of weeks, I think, you know, when the trim notice goes out, we have to put a number on the trim notice just to show you that in 2019, where were we at, 2020. And so we come up with a number. It was very hard for me to get to that number for 21 because I know personally I'm not voting for that number. And I don't think we are here as well. The fire assessment is something that is a balanced assessment for everybody that owns property inside the city of Panama City. There are large properties that aren't paying now but would pay for this, that balance that out for all of us. And if we do the fire assessment, I know in my conversations with staff, is to champion the ad valorem tax to be lower than where it's at. My goal is to shoot it down to 4.99, get it under 5. That's my goal, if the fire assessment at some form passes there, because we are in debt. We did get there. And if you look at history, as the gentleman said, we did 27% and then 41%, and I would agree with them. But let's go back a little farther than that. For 19 years prior to that, we were at 3.97, and the city didn't do anything. We didn't fix any infrastructure that was failing. I spent Tuesday of last week all day with the underground utilities. I will share that later in this meeting, what that experience was. And if you guys go, I'm on board for anything that you do. I mean, we have terracotta pipes. We have cast iron pipes. We have 18 people working on underground utilities. And I think some of them are doing the lift stations. And if you looked at the lift stations in your community, it's bad. It's bad. And we have a small crew and no money to fix those things. And so that's all part of what we look at. I trust when I talk to staff, I spend a lot of time with staff talking about the budget. And I trust them when they go to the department heads and said, what do you need? And then when they get done what they need, they go back and say, now you got to cut that. And you got to go down to the bare minimum if the commission doesn't approve any changes to the ad valorem tax or a fire assessment or whatever it may be. We have lost probably about 4,000 people inside our community that we didn't have before. It's coming back. I mean, the numbers, COVID-19 did not help. You look at across the United States and all communities, when you look at those numbers, they're bad. It's coming back. I feel good that 21 is going to be a great year for all of us. But for us, we got to look at that balance on where do we put this? And for you, we've got to communicate that to you. I've reached out to people that sent me emails and called me and just said, hey, tell me about it, because they saw the trim notice. I got 9 of them. So I know what they were feeling. And I know in my heart, we're not going to approve what you saw in that trim notice. I'm one person. It takes 3 to do that, I think. But I think we need to make sure that the city is viable, to make sure that if it's the good water or the sewer, we're not dumping it out in the bay, like some of the pipes that we have are in the bay. It's not cheap to fix those things. And we've been patching for a long period of time. Picking up your trash. I mean, I'm taking a ride next week with the solid waste department just to see what we do. And I've heard stories about it, and I know they do a great job, but it takes a lot of money.
We have a lot of equipment. You talked about new equipment as well that, you know, why now? Because we haven't bought any for 10 years or 15 years, and they're driving old vehicles, and they got to be replaced. They have a lifespan. If they're driving them day in and day out for 8 to 10 years, and you can work maintenance on them, but it's not like the vehicles that we drive. These things got to be replaced, and they're expensive to do that. So I had a lot of questions for myself here. You know, when I talk to staff is, you know, what are we doing to make sure we hold our own? Because it has been tough time for Hurricane Michael. It's been tough time with the COVID, and now we're putting a little extra tax on people on based on what you saw. And so we got to make sure that we think about everybody when we look at an assessment or an ad valorem tax. And again, I just clarify that the newspaper article had two new assistant managers. It's only one that's in there. I read that myself. I even brought the paper with me. To me is that this so with the fire assessment, I know we'll be talking about next week, is that money, even though we call it fire assessment, we could apply it to the fire department. That money we've been spending in the fire department comes back to the general fund to do the things that we need to do. And then with that, as we grow and the debt that we recover, that we're still in the debt that we'll always have there, is as we grow and as people come back, then we could reduce that fire assessment. Or even better, like the mayor said, is maybe leave the fire assessment and let's reduce the ad valorem tax on all of us that are paying that that some of these other properties are not. So that were just my comments I wanted to share. But it's one is we, you know, when you read the paper, you watch the news, or you get a piece of paper, there's more to it. And what I encourage you to do, reach out to us, reach out to the city staff, ask your questions on how we got here. I know we're going to be doing it next week and we're going to be doing it in 2 weeks, but hopefully we'll be able to share how we got here, just not that we're raising a tax, and that's not what we want to do. So that's it.
Okay. Don't have to bat.
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
Thank you. You know, I have to agree with what Commissioner Nichols said. I don't want to take a lot of time, and what the mayor said, because I think they did a pretty doggone good job of explaining things. Each year, we are tasked, this commission is, and every municipality in Bay County and the county, with setting a tentative millage rate, those that have an ad valorem tax. There are some cities that do not have an ad valorem, but we do. And each year, in years past, we haven't had big-time emergencies. I mean, I can go back to 1995 when Hurricane Opal hit, you know. But I wasn't a commissioner then, but I certainly remember it. It was bad. But nothing has ever compared to 2018. So we went through that. And like our city manager said, you know, and the mayor said, thank God we've got great credit. We were able to get to borrow money, you know. And the rule of thumb is you hate borrowing money, stay afloat, but you got to have cash flow. It is a business. The city is a business. But the city is also in the business of providing services. And I remember after the hurricane, I had people calling me and saying, Billy, how come you guys aren't picking up trash twice a week right now? You know, well, we couldn't get everybody out there to do that because we were doing other things, you know. And they just some people had a fit. So first thing I thought of, well, why don't we just cut trash, garbage, you know, to one day a week? But then I remember what those folks said, you know. The point I'm trying to make is, and I'm not trying to get off of the beaten path, but each of us have a little different take on this, I think. But when it comes to the bottom line, we all have the same take. We really don't know what's going to happen with the fire assessment, okay? And so it's hard to park the buggy exactly where it needs to be parked, knowing that it might be in the wrong spot, you know, after the fire assessment meeting. And I will say this, I've had people call me, just like the mayor and Commissioner Nichols and everybody else, and quote figures to me about the fire assessment, and with all due respect, and they mean well, but there's a mathematical equation, and they're not always figuring it right. And so on the city website, I encourage you to go to that website, type in your address or your name, and I think it calculates it for you. So, as I said, here's what I wanted to say. I remember now. We've got 35 miles of ditches in the city. I forget what I'm going to say. 35 miles of ditches. And I wasn't aware we had that many miles of ditches until Hurricane Michael. And a lot of those miles are in my district. They're everywhere, but a lot of them are in my district. And it's imperative that those ditches operate, that they function, that water, if it don't go right, you know, you got major problems, super major problems. And then you got roads that'll wash out. You know, it's got to flow. It's got to go right. So, and then people call and say, you're not mowing enough. You're not cleaning those ditches enough. You're letting that grow too high, Billy. Get over and get that done, you know. And that's what happens, you know. So do we want to increase that, you know, mowing in the summertime? I don't know. But I know aesthetics are important. I also know that it's important for the water to flow. There's just so many unknowns right now, and in the double whammy of COVID-19, you know, with the uncertainty of what we're going to receive from the state of Florida. And so I just encourage you all to be patient. I don't think we can answer every question today properly, and if I went too long, I humbly apologize. But each of us are doing our very best to dig in there and do our due diligence on this task. So thank you for your patience with me.
Thank you, Commissioner.
Probably just going to wait till some other people talk.
Brown?
You
want to
say anything?
Oh, yes. I'll go ahead and say a little bit. Well, one thing that since I became a commissioner in Panama City many years ago, I had a lady to call me from Millville. It wasn't in the Glenwood community. And she was having problems with her water. That's supposed to be fresh water, the water we drink and bathe. And I went and checked it out. The water was coming out black. And we reported it. And the city come out and found out that it was from some old lines. But she reported it, but nothing came about out of it. So she came to the city commission and she presented it in a water, in the commission meeting, in a bottle of water that came from her faucet. And it was pure black. But cut the story short, that's what it took to come and show the city the conditions of the water at her home. It made her sick. That was one way that we got the people's attention to bring it out. We had to do a show and tell. But there is a lot of people here that has that same contaminants in their drinking water, but they don't report it. They got the feeling that says it's not going to do any good. We'll report it for years. What I'm saying, keep reporting it. Because one thing about Panama City, we need more money to operate. We need more money to operate. Now, what was the infrastructure before Hurricane Michael? It was bad then. So now it's got to be worse. The water quality to maintain and get everything done, it's not cheap. It's not cheap to fix it. But since Hurricane Michael, everything has gotten down. We have to come up with some criteria to combat this and bring it on a little bit more even plane. With everyone sitting here so far have spoke on the condition that Panama City is in. Panama City was in that condition before Hurricane Michael. You can't put it all on Hurricane Michael, but you can put it on until we get things working to the best, to where we can combat all of these inconsistencies. We need money to buy equipment. We need money to hire more workers. That's going to be the key to what it's going to be for us to come out on top. Thank you.
That's it.
I'm just going to wait until some people talk, because I'm sure I'll have more to say.
Okay. At this time, we'll have the commission will hear comments and questions from the public relative to the tentative millage rates and tentative budgets for the City of Panama City and the Downtown Improvement District. If you'd like to come forward, give your name and address, because this is a public hearing.
I got what y'all been talking about. Morgan Strickland, 1217 Blue Stem Street, Panama City Park.
Reading from Mr. McLean, whatever his name is, here, McQueen.
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 Like Steve McQueen.
Steve McQueen.
Would you pull the mask off? We can't hear you, sir. Pull it down.
Get the microphone.
Understand. Yes.
You guys turn him up back there.
It's a little more.
We need to hear you.
The front page on this article in the paper says that y'all were expecting $200 million from state and local government, state and federal government for capital projects. That should be sewer.
Nope.
No sewer. What you going to use it for?
You want to
let Mr. McQueen address it?
Go ahead. You go ahead and finish, and then he'll address it.
Here we got $4.6 million that's supposed to come into the city coffers from this fire assessment fee. The next paragraph down, he's spending $3 million of that money on three new expenditures. He's spending $3 million right there. So that eats up two-thirds of your fire assessment fee with one swipe.
With what? Say it again.
In his article, I'm reading from the newspaper.
I want to hear what he said.
You can't always believe the newspaper.
No, you can't. No.
But it says right here that the fire assessment fee will bring the city coffers $4.6 million. The next paragraph down, see, he also prepares three new expenditures, $1 million, $1.3 million, and $947,000. That eats up two-thirds of your fire assessment fee right there before you even add it into what we already trying to do and owe.
That's what I thought you said.
That the city has to, you know, handle their money and take care of the infrastructure. I know there's bad water lines. I worked over in the Millville area for almost 40 years. And that area there is though, you got some of them just got old galvanized pipe to rust into.
You're right.
And all that. So I agree with them that they need some infrastructure money. Maybe you need to look at more so than the $3 million for these new expenditures that they're going to do.
Thank you, sir.
Mr. McQueen,
I
would love for you to address some of this, though.
Okay. Anyone else?
Hi, Mike Rowan, 239 South Cove Terrace. I came here to talk about the fire assessment, and I understand it's going to be next week, mm-hmm. and people talk about you haven't made a decision. Well, I believe it's a done deal, but I'm going to come here next week and see. So that's comment number one. You've raised the millage rate in 2018 and 2019, and now you're proposing a raised millage rate this year also. So people need to understand that. I think Ronald Reagan talked about people having taxing problem. They have a spending problem. And that's the problem that you folks have. You have a spending problem. We need to cut back on services. You talk about money that we're going to have in the future. Well, let's wait until we get to the future and see if we have that money or not, so we'll know whether we're going to be able to spend it or not. I noticed at a commission meeting recently you spent $40,000 for a sunshade at Jinx School. I think all of us love kids, but I don't think it's our job to provide a sunscreen or a sunshade out of city money for $40,000. Again, I think we have a spending problem here. We need to cut back on services. We need to do what it takes. It's a terrible time right now. We all know about Hurricane Michael. We'll probably never have another one, hopefully in our lifetime anyway. And then we've got this virus pandemic, this political pandemic that is going on right now. So the people in Panama City have been dealt a double whammy, and now you folks are fixing to strangle our necks and give us the third whammy. You're going to increase our taxes.
If we do.
You're
it's
going
tentative.
To. You can take that to the bank, Billy. You're going to increase the taxes.
Well, I'm glad you got such a great forecast.
I'll be around watching, but it's going up. Or else
you know
you
I love
use
you, brother.
Other money.
Sorry.
Let's see, I think that's about all I have to say right at the moment, but I'll be around.
All right, thanks, Doc.
I'll be happy to discuss it if you want, Bill.
That's all right, Doc, anytime.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Thank you.
Hello, how are you doing?
Fine.
I'm John Haley, my address is 601 Cactus Avenue. One of the things I want to say about the scenario that we're dealing with right now, I think you guys are going to basically assess us twice. You're going to assess us twice in that you're going to assess where we live. And not only are you going to assess where we live, you're going to assess where we worship. The church doesn't get money from the government. The church gets money from parishioners where they pay their tithe. They pay their offering. So not only do we have to pay to live, basically $176 per portion, and then when we go to the church doesn't survive off of government funds. May or may not get grants, but by and large, it survives off of tithing and the offering from the people. So in reality, the people are being assessed twice, not once, but twice. And not only that, when you look at the scenario panoramically, if you look around the county, the state, and the municipalities around the state, the basic assessment fee for fire assessment comes nowhere near $176. Sometimes it's $40, other times it's $83. Sometimes it's charged quarterly by $44 and $43. But it's nowhere near a flat fee of $176 flat. And then it almost amounts to the cable bill because there's four additional assessments after the basic assessment. You know, cable bills go on and on and on and on. They never stop, seemingly. And that's the way this scenario here is. There's four additional charges on top of the base fee. And so what happens is this. You end up with a larger fee than what is actually put on the paper. Then you ask the question is this. If every partial is going to be given $176 base fee, then you look at scenarios where you have developers who have partials put together and they build complexes on the partial. In some municipalities, they charge a base fee per family dwelling. Well, in some of these scenarios, you got 92 dwellings on those partials. Well, if you were to multiply 92 times 176, you get somewhere in the neighborhood of $16,000. Well, but if you go back and look at the paperwork, the assessment, you'll see those apartments are probably built on three or four partials. But more than likely, that developer is probably going to only be charged $176 versus one family member who would be charged $176. He has 92 people in living in that dwelling place, and may only be charged $176. So when you look at the scenario in the opening sentence and the notification, it says the most fair way of doing this. This is a rhetorical question. Is it?
Thank you.
God bless you.
Thank you.
I do just want to clarify on what he's saying. Everybody has one parcel, but where they would pay significantly more than other people is on their building, their improvement, their vertical structure.
Right. Correct.
Walter P. Henry, 614 Maple Avenue, Panama City, Florida. Thank God for Dr. Haley. One problem I have with the taxes y'all are doing, the Bible said the poor would be with us always. We're talking about after nobody paid these taxes, y'all talking about putting a lien on their property. I mean, we need to find something else, another way. I know we saying that others don't pay. I've been back, my grandparents, I've seen it hard times. That they was not able to do what some of us doing this at this modern time. But we should not, we ask folks to do something, but we go put a lien on their property as well if they don't pay it. I don't see that. The other thing I want to talk to you about, I've been telling y'all ever since I've been coming to this meeting, I know y'all talk about sewer, water, saying what you don't have. You have it. Think about it, you're not using it. It's in the ground, sitting there, not being used. And when y'all people called me one day and wanted to know how to cut off the Messalina housing project, I told them I was not finna tell the city how to cut off the Messalina housing project. Do I know how to shut it off? So we'll tell y'all, we can sit down and we can sit down and talk. Tell y'all plenty of things y'all need to know that y'all already have, already in place. I don't know if it's going in one ear, and right out of the other ear. It's something that you put money in that you don't have to. You can save some of it. You can save some. I worked, I'm superintendent over the water department for 12 years before I retired. I had less men than what y'all talking about now. I laid sewer main for y'all. I laid forest main, I laid water line with the little crew I got. And most every time I see y'all get something, y'all having a contractor to do it. I took a few men. We laid the main sewers. I put in lift station. I got damaged putting in a 25-foot lift station for y'all. And y'all did not, when I retired, y'all throw me under the bus.
Thank you, Mr. Henry.
I just want to let y'all know, y'all need to think about it. Check your city, check your records. Go down there in the engineer department, check the maps if they done did what they supposed to do.
Thank you. Anyone else?
James Barker, 1018 Curtis Avenue, Panama City, Florida. I want to say a couple of things. I know we're not talking about the assessment, so I'm not going to speak on the assessment, even though I will be back to speak on the assessment. I do want to speak on the budget. One thing about the budget, I know we need extra money with the storm and all. My thing is, are we going to spend the money where it needed? Because Millville needs it. Glenwood needs it. Are we just going to get it and spend it where people already have it, where the projects are already built? So now, if you're going to assess people, put the priorities. Millville has been neglected. Glenwood has been neglected for years as far as the pipe and the sewers. What she was talking about the water, that's ridiculous. That's not just in one place over there. You turn on faucets, you get brown water. And the first thing the health department or the city department of water say, well, it's drinkable. Who wants to drink brown water? Are you going to do something about that? Or are you just going to say, okay, we'll get to it when we get to it. Like you always say. I've been begging for years for the city water, the sewer line and the city water to be redone in Glenwood and Millville, especially over here in the area where on Curtis Avenue, because I know at last they burst all the time. But over in Millville and Glenwood, we've been neglected for the sewer and everything for the longest. You talking about increasing the budget? I just want to know where we stand on that. Are we going to be the last one to receive anything? Or are we going to be in there? How is the budget going to be held? That's my concern. You going to increase the budget? Show us where it's going to go first. Show us if we're going to be included in it. Or are you going to go down there and spend some more money? I'm not saying you can't spend money anywhere else in any other town, but we need to know, are we going to be part of the first? We're tired of being a part of the last. Are we going to be part of the first? We want to be first sometime. You know, the Bible says the first shall be last and the last shall be first. We've been last a long time, so it's time for us to be first. So that's what I want to say about the budget. All right. And I'm going to say this about the assessment. It's not about the assessment. What the assessment is this. I don't think that we should assess people to put liens on their property. I think we should find another way to collect the assessment if you're going to assess. It's enough people lose their properties through tax liens and everything else for the city to impose another tax on their lien on their property. So if you can find another way to even think about that, you should do that. Thank you.
Thank you, Barker.
Just a quick statement.
Luke, tell us your name.
Yes, sir. Lucas Luco, 1117 and a half Jinx Avenue, Panama City. At this time, I'm in a rental, but I've lived here since 1960. I just want to say two things. I think the fire assessment's a little bit too much, too quick, in light of the hurricane and the COVID. And another idea would be another sales tax increment or whatever. Just another idea to help offset the necessary improvements, which I know from personal experience in the building industry that there are old lines and some of them aren't even known about. But that's basically all I had. Thank you.
Thanks, Luke. Anyone else? Okay, we've already had comments from the commissioners. And I'll entertain a motion for adoption of the tentative millage rate of 6.6201, understanding that this is not the final rate. This is the maximum rate that we can assess. Depending on whether we vote to accept the fire assessment next week or whether or not we hear any more from the state as to what we would be getting from the state so we can finish balancing our budget. So I'm entertaining that motion.
Greg, can I talk about the infrastructure really quick? Because I think there's a little bit of misunderstanding about that too. So when we talk about that we're getting money, it's I don't know what word to use because I don't want to get in trouble for saying it, but I don't know how we ever would have been able to do all the work that we're going to be able to do on the infrastructure besides the fact of the money that's going to come in for it. And it's not going to come in. It's already been obligated, which means that we have to prepare, and we can't just take it and do projects. We have to pay for the project. And then we get reimbursed. So there has to be cash flow for that as well. In addition to that, I know recently we got approved for the state revolving fund for about $80 million, and 20 of that, we hope, will be forgiven, but it'll be a 20-year loan at 0% interest rate for us to continue doing $80 million in additional infrastructure. We think it's probably about $1 million a mile. We have about 250 miles. And Mr. Barker, you're right, it's really bad over there, but it's bad in every historic area. So the Cove is terrible, Millville is terrible, parts of St. Andrew's terrible, and Glenwood's terrible. So I would assume that all of those areas will probably be addressed first, since that's the oldest infrastructure in the city. But also with the state revolving fund, that debt service, even though it's 0%, is going to be about $3 million a year. It costs money. You know, we're very blessed that we'll have to put, considering, very little money into those projects. And I feel like I'm just as frustrated as anybody else. I mean, I've been talking about infrastructure. I can't imagine how long y'all been talking about it. And I personally really need to see something change as well. And I know all these are right here on the forefront, but we need to get on it. I mean, we got to get on this infrastructure, and I don't know how to go any quicker. I know, Johnny, you're working really hard, and everybody's working hard. But anyway, I just wanted to say that because I think a lot of people, and when we get obligated money, like, for example, for parks, it can only be used for parks. Like, we can't take that and put it in the general fund. And it's really just to improve what Hurricane Michael took away from us. So same thing with the Civic Center or the old City Hall, all of that can only be used for the same type of purpose. So just kind of keep that in, I just wanted to keep that in mind. And also, when you're talking about liens on property, there is going to be a program that's going to be a hardship deferment. They'll still have to pay at some point, but it won't take someone's house away from them if they qualify for that. If it's really, truly a hardship on somebody, it will. And the only other thing I wanted to say is that in 2018, our budget was around $45.5 million. And that was with the same complaints that everybody knows of. Not cutting right-of-ways enough, the parks look like crap, you know, just the infrastructure, and there's manhole caving in and everything else. There's nothing extra, nothing extra. Well, people say sharpen your pencils. Well, the staff has. I mean, we have a budget that's $6 million less than what it was in 2018. And in 2019, from 2019 to this year's proposed budget is not changed at all. There's no, oh, we're just going to add. They just figured out how to cut in other places to make other things a priority that we know that you want. And I think Mark says it best when he's like, what do you want? What do you want to buy? You know, what kind of city? Well, we want to buy that infrastructure. We don't want to let that go, so we know how important that is. So I just wanted to just kind of give a little bit of update on that and just a little clarification that if it's a true hardship on somebody, there will be a deferment for them. Nobody would take their house away. So.
And we had a 14% decrease, and this year a 5% increase. So that means we're still 9% under on value. Everybody get that?
Well, and I think just like he said, I think a lot of people forget that we're sitting up here. We're going to have to pay it too. You know, it's a burden for us too. But what we've realized through this process is that the burden is heavy on people who own property and nobody else. I mean, even just looking at those numbers, almost 70% of the people who do own properties, about 12,000 properties out of 17,000, are paying either $0 up to $500 a year. I mean, that's not a lot when you have a $40 million budget, you know? So it's okay, but then you have 30% of those people are carrying the majority of the property ad valorem. So I do agree that we need to figure out how to promote home ownership, which is going to be less ad valorem and more shared cost. So anyway. That's all I
got to
say about that.
Okay. All right. So I entertain a motion at 6.6201.
So let me make a comment before we make any motions, just to clarify it again so the people that are here could hear it.
Go ahead.
And then how they do the story, how they write it, mm-hmm. is I'd rather the fire assessment been done last week.
Mm-hmm. Me too.
Yes. And yep. And the budget this week. But unfortunately, we're having the fire assessment next week. The true vote on what we do is in 2 weeks on the 21st at 5:01 p.m. right here. That's important. So whatever we say today is just something to move us down the road to see what happens next week on the fire assessment. I've been clear to everybody. 6.6 is not where I'm going 2 weeks from now. I'm just letting you know that now. That's not going to happen. But I think by having the conversation and see where we end up next week is just something on a piece of paper. The real vote and what we do is going to be in 2 weeks. So I just want to be clear on that. It's just not what we're establishing today or whatever the motion is going to be.
Okay.
Yeah. So I just want to clarify that. So.
And I kind of feel like this. I'm comfortable no matter what at freezing where we're at. Because like you, even if the fire assessment doesn't pass, which I think is pretty obvious that I think that it's a more fair assessment, if it doesn't pass, I'm not going to put even more burden on those that are already paying property ad valorems. And that'll be really tough, really tough thing. But unless somebody has some major reason, I don't have a problem just saying, going ahead and saying, you know, that's just how I feel. I would rather just say, hey, let's be at the 5.5. But whatever we're already exist at you this.
Know. Okay, so, all right, so we've all said our piece, and I didn't hear a motion for that. So I'm going to assume that we're not going to have that number. And so I will then, not to cut you off.
I think that would be a good, I think that would be a good thing for the community, saying, hey, if we're committed, that we're not going to go there. So I'll make the motion that we keep the ad valorem tax, bring it back down to the 5.5469, with the opportunity to still change that based on what happens next week, 2 weeks from now. Okay? So okay. Where we're at, and if y'all approve the fire assessment and that goes through, then I'm going to champion a lower ad valorem tax below that number.
Okay, so we have a motion at 5.5469, which is the current rate. I hear a second.
Yes, I'll second the motion, and just like Commissioner Nichols said, we can go to the rollback rate, which is 5.2385, if we have to. But this is dropping it down from what we had last time.
All right. Any other discussion?
I would like to say in the chart you gave us, and just so it gives me something to think about before next meeting, in the chart you gave us, we were working negative at even with 4.99 and the fire assessment. Okay, and that's still, we're negative and we're taken out of reserves, the $1.8 million that we have to pay in interest for Hurricane Michael. And if we want to do body cams, has to come out of reserve, and that's an annual cost. And some essential workers that we have to have. Does that include, because the one thing I know for sure is like with Public Works, we've realized now how much more we need. When you say essential workers, does that include some of the public works that we were talking about? Okay. But this is what I want everybody to understand. And this is what Mark has made very clear to me. If we go lower than the 5.5 and no fire assessment, not only will we not be doing anything extra than we're doing right now in the sense of maintenance and right-of-ways and things that you're saying, but we will have less than what we're doing right now. And we get, I know I get hammered, by the way, oh, no, but you can't take care of this and you don't do that. And you're right. I mean, we can't. So just know that whatever y'all tell us you want us to support and whatever we think is best and following the lead of Mark, that we've also got to progress. And we've got to figure out, we are doing things to drive economic development. And, I mean, we're making lots of changes. I could go on day to day with that. But I encourage anyone to go to my Facebook page because I posted on there what we're doing that doesn't cost. Some things cost money, some don't. But to improve economic development, generate more revenue, takes more burden off the taxpayer. But we're in this together. Like Mike said, he's got 9 properties. I have 6. And it's a, you know, whoever it's, it doesn't matter. It's equal to whoever is going through it. But everybody just needs to remember that. That's where we are. That's where we are.
Okay. So. Any other discussion?
So if I heard you correctly. No,
you can't come up again. We've already, sorry.
So
I can talk to you afterwards.
Okay.
Okay. And we'll do that. All right. So
5.54.
Yes. So we got a motion at 5.546. Do you want to speak? Come on.
Rocky Harris, 1305 East 2nd Court, Panama City. I heard about your 5.4, and with the assessment, does that mean this number will stay the same, but still add on to that the department?
Maybe. If we pass the fire assessment.
Would it, okay, fire assessment doesn't get approved. Okay, would you then say, okay, we'll go back to the 6.6.
You cannot go up. You cannot go up.
So it's
you have
either
to go, stay there or go down.
It's either no or both. Is that fair to say?
Sure. Yep.
Okay. And I would vote for, like Mr. Rohan said, that let's go with some kind of other half cent, which we really don't like because it pushes people going to Destin to buy a car, going somewhere else.
We don't have any half cents available.
Can't do it.
Yeah, we have no sales tax.
We're already using one for infrastructure, and schools got one. There isn't one available for us.
You have to go on a ballot anyway.
Yeah.
And,
I don't think.
But I just like to say that, like other people have commented on, that it is a bad time. And we all know that. But let's just sort of wait till some money comes in. That's what I would say. And the gentleman back there, thank you for your service, said we already have five departments right now, fire departments. And according to Mr. Perry of the lawyers, he's told me that a lot of them work together. So for that aspect of it, I think we can make the fire departments better, but without raising money. That's just right after.
Okay, thank you.
My little walking friend, he keeps me on my toes, walking through the cove, getting on to me about these fire assessments. You have been, I'm just teasing.
Thank you. Anyone else?
David Smith, 1070 East Caroline Boulevard, Panama City. And I want to say, I want to live in the best city in the Panhandle, the most premier city. And we have so many things that we need to fix to get us there. We need to fix that infrastructure, the water, the sewer, they make downtown beautiful, make San Andreas beautiful, Millville, Glenwood, all need to come up. And you know what? We can't get there unless we pony up and pay for it. And so I say, we pony up and pay for it. I own four properties, and it's gonna hurt me. But I also wanna live in the best city in the Panhandle. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Might be hard to believe. Anyone
else?
Not the only one who says that.
No.
A lot of people agree with
you. Okay, so we got a motion. Do we have a motion and a second?
Yeah.
For the 5.5469. Yep. Any other discussion? Call the roll, please.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brennicki?
Yes, ma'am.
So the tentative millage rates are 5.5469 mills for the city's general fund operating purposes and 3.0000 mills for the downtown improvement district. The city's rate is 1.0732 mills less than the rate previously provided to the county property appraiser for the public notification. The downtown improvement district's rate is the same as previously provided to the county property appraiser. Together, they constitute a current aggregate millage rate of 5.6009 mills, an increase of 5.80% over the current aggregated rollback rate of 5.2942 mills. The tentative budgets under consideration contain expenditures which total $108,232,970, excluding interfund transfers for the city, and $211,864 for the downtown improvement district.
DIB millage rate.
Yes. Do I hear a motion that we pass or 3.0 mills for the Downtown Improvement Board?
Yeah, I'll move a motion for that.
Second a motion, Mayor.
Any discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brennicki?
Yes, ma'am. Anything else to come before us regarding this public hearing?
We need to approve the tentative budgets for the city and the DIB.
Okay.
You got to state something?
So we will need a motion.
Okay, do we hear a motion to approve the tentative budget for the DIB and the City of Panama City?
Move approval.
Second a motion, Mayor.
Any other discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brennicki?
Yes, ma'am. We'll close the public hearing. Go on. We have a notice of upcoming appointment to the Downtown Improvement Board for an unfilled term to expire October the 9th, 2021. If you're interested, contact Ms. Waldron at City Hall. This is the first notice of upcoming appointments to the Infrastructure Surtax Committee for terms expired December 31st, 2022. If you're interested, please contact Ms. Waldron at the City Hall. now we have to, this time of year, we have to have to appoint a mayor pro tem. Last year, Ms. Halagus filled that position, and we generally rotate that, but do I hear a motion from anyone?
I'll move that Commissioner Brown be mayor pro tem.
Okay.
If he accepts.
Mr. Mayor, I would gladly accept that position.
Very good.
I'll second that motion.
Okay. That's easy.
No fight there.
No discussion, so please call the roll.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brodnicki?
Yes, ma'am. Nevin?
Thank you. First item is a vote to approve the ratification of the extension of state of emergency on Hurricane Michael.
Hear a motion?
Yes, sir. I'd like to move approval.
It's extensions 98 and 99.
Of extensions 98 and 99 for the ratification.
Hear a second?
Second motion, Mayor.
Discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brodnicki?
Yes, ma'am.
Request commission to approve extensions number 24 and 25 for state of emergency COVID-19.
Your motion on extension 24 and 25?
Mr. Mayor, I would like to make that motion.
I'll second your motion, Mr. Brown.
Discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brodnicki?
Yes, ma'am.
The next item is a request to approve an interlocal agreement with the county. For context, where this interlocal agreement comes from is that when the old Buccaneer Lounge was torn down, it was determined to have as asbestos contaminated materials. And those materials could only be disposed of at the landfill, the Steelfield landfill that's operated by the county. There was a letter that was sent in January from City Manager McQueen to County Manager Micah and requested permission to have the fee waived until the money was collected from the property owner. That is pursuant to a resolution that the county had adopted. That is acceptable to the county. They have, for auditing purposes, they have requested an interlocal agreement to track that. And they've also requested, and I recommend also, there'd be a sentence added to what you have. It says, right now it says that within 2 years that this would be paid. It's within, but also they'd like to add that the city will diligently attempt to collect, and when collected, then go ahead and pay the county. This number, this $90,000, is part of the $438,000 assessment, nuisance abatement assessment, that you will be considering levying on this piece of property next week. And so that, if you approve it, that $438,000 will appear as an assessment on their tax bill. It's obviously a nice piece of property, well worth $438,000. And so we anticipate that it will be paid for probably sooner, because there's also a developer, as you know, that's been in hoping to do something. So our recommendation is to approve the interlocal. Thank you.
Move approval.
I'll second.
Any other discussion? I was trying to be nice.
I'm sorry.
Call the roll.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brodnicki?
Yes, ma'am. Mr. McQueen?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Draw your attention to item 8A, which is the first reading of ordinance 2753, the platted right-of-way vacation, platted alley right-of-way located between 117 Harmon Avenue and 125 Harmon Avenue. As background information, the adjacent property owner is requesting the platted right-of-way be vacated to prevent public access. The Planning Board considered this item on its August 10th, 2020 meeting, and the request was recommended for approval unanimously. The recommendation is to conduct the first reading of the ordinance.
First reading of ordinance 2753, an ordinance vacating and abandoning platted alley right-of-way located between 117 Harmon Avenue and 125 Harmon Avenue, Panama City, Florida,
as more particularly hereinafter described, repealing all ordinances in conflict herewith, providing for the severability of any part of this ordinance declared invalid, and providing for an effective date.
Items 8B and C, or 8B, 8C, and 8D have all been rescheduled to be heard for the first reading on October 27th, 2020. Draw your attention to item 8E, which is the final payments for sub-consultant data collection City of Panama City of signs, sidewalks, guardrails, and inlets impacted by Hurricane Michael. As background information, the Panhandle Engineering, Dewberry, Metric Engineering, and DRMP have completed the data collection of the City of Panama City's signs, sidewalks, guardrails, and inlets that have been impacted by Hurricane Michael in Wards 1, 2, 3, and 4. The total project cost was $269,613. The work has been satisfactorily completed, and all firms will remain available to assist with responding to FEMA requests for information and other questions that they may have to help to move forward on that project formulation. The total final payment is $33,844.03. As such, it's recommended for the final payments for Panhandle Engineering in the amount of $19,874.40, to Dewberry in the amount of $3,182.15, to Metric Engineering in the amount of $2,494.90, and to DRMP in the amount of $8,292.58.
Okay, do I hear a motion on 8E?
Move approval of item 8E.
Your second?
Second the motion, Mayor.
Any other discussion? Call the roll.
Commissioner Halagus?
Yes.
Commissioner Brown?
Yes.
Commissioner Rader?
Yes.
Commissioner Nichols?
Yes.
Mayor Brodnicki?
Yes.
Item 8F, as you know, several months ago, this commission embarked on the new rate studies for both solid waste and for our water and sewer. We are deferring to a later date on any discussions with regard to water and sewer based on the desire for the city to pursue additional capital funds that could be offset so that it's not borne in the rate study. So as a result, the solid waste technical rate study presentation is being presented to you by Raf Tellis. And Murray, I turn the dais podium over to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. McQueen. Mr. Mayor. Members of the City Commission, again, for the record, my name is Murray Hamilton. I'm a senior manager at Raf Tellis. We're a utility rate and financial consulting firm with our Florida office located just north of Orlando in Maitland, Florida. As you well know, last week you received a copy of our detailed report, and for tonight's presentation, we've condensed that to a brief summary in order to review our recommendations and conclusions of the study. Most specifically, the city asked us to review the adequacy of the solid waste utility system, the rates for the next five-year forecast period through fiscal year 2025. In doing so, we looked at a projection of your customer and revenues, operating and disposal expenses, the capital needs in order to help facilitate the solid waste services. Also taking into consideration new customer growth within the utility system. For the forecast period, we're basically looking at the annual revenue requirements and how those rates are adequate over the study period. In addition, city staff provided us a list of some miscellaneous utility fees that they asked us to also review for adequacy. And overall, we're looking to set a rate path for the next five-year period. Our last rate study for the Solid Waste Department was concluded in May of 2017. The majority of the emphasis was on supporting the conversion of the existing fleet at the time to compressed natural gas. The City Commission did adopt our rate path, annual 5% annual rate increases, actually through fiscal year 2022. And so absent any action later this month, the City Commission had already adopted a 5% increase for 2021 as well as for 2022. So 3 years of the current rate plan has been implemented. Prior to Hurricane Michael, again, the system was financially strong with more than $4 million in the operating reserve fund. Almost twice the minimum reserve fund requirement, more than 200 days of operations. Also, the solid waste system was generating a positive cash flow in order to continue to reinvest in fleet. After Hurricane Michael, initially the system lost 1,400 customer accounts, primarily commercial accounts, but up to this point in time has recovered just slightly. The system serving still less, 1,000 less customers than it was before, which obviously has impacted revenues. Annual revenues are down approximately $1.9 million, almost 27% of the overall annual source. And to compound the issue, the city's tipping fees for yard waste disposal has more than doubled, again, also since the hurricane. Recently, Bay County has voted to close the incinerator, which could happen within a year's time. Based on discussions with city staff, we think it's more likely that the incinerator may close by April of next year. Both the city and county have looked into owning or operating their own transfer stations. Those programs don't appear feasible at this time, as we discussed and outlined in our report. City staff has a lower cost option than the transfer station, and quite frankly, to take the waste to Steelfield landfill directly, it is a 1 hour round trip per day per driver, an extra round extra hour, if you will, to facilitate the lower cost plan. City staff has included only one new position in the 2021 budget, also a vehicle to support that position, again, to facilitate the round trips. Overwhelmingly, those costs are offset by projected decreases in the tipping fee. Again, taking the waste directly to Steelfield landfill, there's a projected savings of just under $800,000 a year, based on the tipping fee declining from a current charge of $58 per ton to roughly $35 a ton. And again, we've taken that into account. Some of the existing conditions, focusing on the 2020 budget at hand, and again, recognizing that our current revenues are down $1.9 million. In the current year, the city only has $6.8 million in solid waste revenues to cover its operating budget, and it falls short. So we have less revenues to actually cover the operating expenses and indirect cost allocation. Those are expenses, too, paid to the general fund. Just on paper, it's short $400,000 a year before looking at the fleet needs, which are $600,000 for the current period, and an annual average of $1.2 million going forward. After considering, what's basically in the bank today to cover that $1 million shortfall, we estimate that at the end of the current budget year, that the cash reserve balance will be slightly below the city's policy, which is a 30% of total annual expenditures, are just under 110 days of operations. What I like about slide six is specifically it helps demonstrate the evolution of this particular study. Working with Mr. Daughtry and Mr. Nix, first and foremost, they cut the capital plan. When they saw what the cash flow shortfall was, the capital plan was reduced $2.5 million, almost 30%. And then, as you can see on slide six, they even went further to try to push the needs out in time, which, quite frankly, gives us some flexibility to help try and phase in the solid waste rates over our study period. And again, you saw that in our report as well. Also, what's highlighted here on slide six is next year's capital outlay, fiscal year 2021, is actually less than the current budget year. And again, I think they've taken a very good steps in order to help provide a phased approach to this. Some key highlights to our major assumptions. Again, we are looking to new growth in the system, hopefully some redevelopment over the study period, just under 1.5% in revenue growth per year over the five-year period. We've evaluated the operating expenses and disposal costs. Again, a decrease in the overall tipping fees as the city takes the waste straight to Steelfield landfill. Again, it doesn't, the budget does include one additional driver. Over the study period, there are five new positions that are earmarked in order to serve new customers of the system. So again, that's tied to the revenue assumptions. And those are out in time, predominantly on the residential yard waste service area, and also a commercial driver as well. Overall, operating expenses are projected to increase just under 3% a year, or 2.8%. Some of our study considerations, of course, first and foremost, to have a balanced budget. I mean, that's our goal here, even as you talk about your general fund budget. Existing revenues today are not able to cover the operating expenses of the system. And so, as you're going to see in our recommendations, we're having to provide somewhat of a stopgap adjustment in the first year, but allowing the reserve balances to recover over time. Maintaining that reserve policy is important. You know, first and foremost, it's going to provide adequate working capital to fund the operating needs of the system. And then secondly, provide a contingency to respond to natural disasters or other unforeseen events. Unfortunately, y'all have had that experience here. One of our key drivers of our recommendations is to phase in the proposed rate increases to the extent possible. Again, as I highlighted, you know, staff reduced the capital plan 30%, $2.5 million, and have deferred the replacement needs, again, over the five-year period. Secondly, no rate increase is proposed sooner than January 1st of 2021. So the solid waste rate increases are being delayed at least 3 months, and our recommendation would be January 1st implementation. Again, city staff also recommends allowing the deficiency in the operating reserve fund to be phased in over a five-year period. So while we provided a few scenarios for examination on slide 9, specifically, I want to highlight the middle option in the center, scenario 2. That's our recommendation. This was our phased approach that we think is a balanced approach, if you will. It phases the adjustments in over a five-year period. To highlight the importance of that, you know, scenario 1 was focused on correcting the reserve fund deficiency in a single year. And in order to do so, it would increase the typical residential customer bill $9.62. Again, that's not our recommendation. We don't think that that's palatable and appropriate this time. And so, again, scenario 2 takes a phased approach. The first increase, January 1st, 2021, if adopted, would be a $4.37 increase in 21. That's a 15% increase for our commercial accounts. And then you can see we have just under a $3 increase in fiscal years 22 and 23, and then under or approximately $2 per month increase in fiscal year 24 and 25. And as you'll see in the center of that page, your reserve fund balance approaches the 110-day minimum requirement again by that last year. Slide 10 just provides you a brief snapshot of what the operating results would look like under the proposed rate path, again, if the rate increases are adopted. As you can see there, the green dotted line at the top is the revenues under those proposed rates. We're not creating an income, if you will, for the system. The goal is to break even in each and every fiscal year, and again, allowing that reserve fund balance to recover over an extended period of time. We have a rate comparison, residential rate comparison, for you as well. Do keep in mind that several factors drive differences among various utilities. Specifically to your system is level of service. And when you look at the rate comparison shown on slide 11, specifically there's only one other utility system on this chart that provides 2 times per week garbage pickup, and that's the City of Mexico Beach, who has a current charge of $29.45 per month on average, which is just greater than your current charge. The proposed charge, again, in January 1st, if approved, would be $33.51. Again, that's for the first residential cart. The other utilities to the far left of the chart only provide one day per week pickup for solid waste. So when you look at the survey average of $25.08, you know, take it with a grain of salt. It is what it is, but the level of service is not equal. Lastly, again, city staff asked us to review some of the miscellaneous charges for the solid waste system. Specifically, you know, customers have opportunities, specifically the commercial customers, to have an extra pickup done if there's an event or some type of activity at that commercial enterprise. And so we've tied the extra dumpster pickups, again, to the stated rate schedule that is at the back of your packet, plus an administrative fee for the untimely service and scheduling. Excess yard waste, again, as I mentioned, the tipping fee to Waste Pro has more than doubled. We've provided a phased approach to those charges over a five-year period and looking and working with city staff. If we tried to true up those charges in the first year, it would be a 45% rate increase for just excess yard pickup, yard waste pickup. So again, we've taken that cost and we've phased it in over a five-year period. Lastly, we have a couple new fees for dumpster locked bars as well as for casters. And again, these services are being provided today at no cost to the commercial accounts. And we're basically recommending to staff that they charge the current cost plus an administrative fee. And then lastly, we at least evaluated the cost of providing dumpster cleaning services. It's not a service that's being recommended at this point in time. Staff, I think, will continue to look at the feasibility of that program, but we did evaluate the cost. And again, at the back of your packet is Attachment A that will provide you a list of the proposed solid waste rates, not just for fiscal year 2021, but also over the five-year study period. In conclusion, again, as a result of Hurricane Michael, the overall revenues, the net revenues are down $1.9 million per year, almost 27%. The existing solid waste rates are not adequate to cover the operating expenses today. So again, that's before considering our replacement fleet. And again, the reserves are no longer adequate to help offset this deficiency, so we need to look at some rate adjustments. Our recommendation is that the City Commission consider Scenario 2, again, a five-year phase rate plan beginning on and after January 1st, 2021, and each October 1st thereafter. And again, if the rates are adopted, we feel that they would, one, fully fund the operating and capital needs over the study period, achieve your cash reserve policy over a five-year period, again, 30% of the annual expenditures, and then lastly, it allows us to phase in the overall rates. And with that, Mr. Mayor, I'm more than happy to answer any questions that the Commission has.
This is coming back later for a vote. This is just a presentation tonight.
Yes.
And they'll come back when? Probably, possibly.
21st.
I have one. This month. Okay. So from there, I know you met with all of us.
Yes, sir.
This week to go through this study, et cetera. And so when you look at those rates and you said option two in here, so for us, if the city grows faster, or people come back faster than what we got here, then we could actually adjust those rates.
Absolutely.
Down or hold them or don't apply any adjustments to it. I know Hurricane Michael got the tipping fees for the yard debris been real bad for us. I mean, that's doubling the price. That's tough. And I think we lost our site for us to do that. Didn't we waive some fees after Hurricane Michael for 3 months or so? We waived fee for our citizens.
Also for the COVID-19 for all of the restaurants, bars, and nightclubs.
We took care of that, mm-hmm. too.
And we absorbed the online payment fees.
And so we also had discussion about the reserve policy, where we're at on that, and maybe instead of 110 days, we dropped that to 90. Have we looked at that again and say maybe reserving 30%, we'd take it down maybe 25% to offset that a little bit? I know we talked about it.
Yes, sir. We did evaluate it, Commissioner. We looked at it. First and foremost, it did not change the rate path for years 1, 2, and 3.
Okay.
So at best, we might be able to, if I go back to that slide where we had the scenarios. Okay, so again, scenario 2 is our recommended rate scenario. So the first 3 years ended up being unchanged. It's the last 2 years, and you can see that because you get to 96 days. That's slightly greater than your 25%. So mathematically, the 5% rate increases may be able to fall to 3. What I would highlight is it's worth $500,000, okay? We're not building any other reserves in addition to the 110 days, so we're not setting aside a separate hurricane reserve. But mathematically, it's worth $500,000 in reserves.
Right. Today.
So today.
Today.
Well, in the future.
Okay.
That's in the future. We've got to get there. But the point is, the City Commission could elect to relax that reserve policy and reduce it just slightly. The best impact you could hope for most likely is going to be in year 4 or 5 of this forecast period.
Well, we still have bond and loan covenants too that we've got to make sure that we cover with the amount of money that we've got in that enterprise fund. So that all those things come to play when you're talking about how much money that you have. And we want to make sure that we don't have a problem when we have to go get more.
So, and you know, again, the real issue is since we had that reserve policy, Hurricane Michael came, we got things done.
That's right.
I mean, other places had hard times getting that done, so we got things done. So, you know, every time you look at a nickel, hey, have we had that conversation about doing this? You know, if we do this, what could happen? I mean, as long as it's on the table, we're talking about it. But, you know, we all championed for years to reduce our fund policies on all avenues across the board. And we got hit by Hurricane Michael, Category 5, the fourth largest storm in the country. I mean, who knew?
Mm-hmm.
But we reduced our fund policies across the board on all departments. So it's just one that's on the table to have a conversation. As long as the city grows and we got a lot of growth potential, that we could look at it each year. And then adjust it from there.
Thanks, Murray. Appreciate your presentation. It's very good.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hamilton. Mr. Mayor and Commissioners, I draw your attention to the last item on the agenda, item 8G, which is consideration of approval to execute and sign the Florida Department of Environmental Protection proposed consent order 20-1273. As background information, Panama City's cross-connection control program was adopted in 1992, and its purpose is to protect the city's potable water system from cross-contamination due to the potential backflow from customers' water connection. Florida Administrative Code requires all public water systems to have a cross-connection control program, and all water connections where a potential cross-contamination risk exists are required to have an appropriate backflow prevention device installed. City of Panama City received the proposed consent order 20-1273 from Florida Department of Environmental Protection enforcing the implementation of this program, particularly the regulation that requires the dedicated irrigation service connections to have an above-ground backflow prevention device. This is the same issue and the exact same consent order that was issued last week to the Bay County. And of course, much conversation with regard to that. With that, we were able to successfully negotiate with DEP to also have the exact same language to give us 5 years to gain compliance. With that, I submit this for your consideration.
Man, I'm gonna reiterate what the county said. I can't believe that we have to do this. I mean, that's every person that has a irrigation meter inside the city is going to have to install one of these. One, they look ugly as whatever. You know, if they could design it a better way, it might be okay. But I mean, it's just that. Two, it's a sprinkler system. Is what they're doing on this. It doesn't make sense. I mean, I could see, you know, maybe you're drinking water and that type of stuff, but you bust your sprinkler. It's water.
Well, what bothers me about the situation is that we're encouraging people, we want to keep property values up, and we want people to not have to pay sewage fees on the water that they use to water their lawns.
Right.
And this is so counterproductive. I mean, I agree with you 100%. I mean, it is what it is, and unless there's some type of lobbying effort that changes something at this particular point in time, it's one of those things that we've got to, unless somebody finally wakes up from the EP, from the DEP standpoint and says, you know, maybe we shouldn't be doing that. But right now, they're not saying that. So,
yeah, let me ask you a question. I don't remember reading the newspaper, and it might have been in there. I know on commercial business, they have to be inspected every year.
Yes, sir.
So the residential is going to have to be every two years.
2 years.
Yes, sir.
And so,
yes, sir.
And we're not going to be inspecting. They'll have to hire an independent person.
That's correct.
To come by. And so will the city be in trouble if they're not inspected, or is the homeowner now going to be in trouble for not getting their cross?
Exactly, both.
Wow. And it's pretty costly. So,
And that's just for the sprinklers, right? So if somebody has a water meter, they don't have to do it with the water meters.
That's correct.
No. Okay, so it's just the sprinkler, so that's good. So it's not going to be everybody,
right?
But it's just the ones that we've identified that has a extra sprinkler
irrigation.
So.
That's correct.
I have a question. If you don't have an irrigation meter, but you have an irrigation system, okay, you have a well, and you got a pump, and you got your substations, does it apply to that?
No.
No.
Only with the meters.
Okay.
All right.
Okay. Thanks. I'm going to invite Mr. Sims, or Kimberly. Are you available? Kimberly Setzer is our director of our utilities. Certainly can answer all of the specifics to the program. It's a fairly detailed program, but Ms. Setzer?
Any auxiliary water system has to have a backflow prevention device, which includes wells.
So if you have a well, or if you have a separate irrigation meter.
So what? The microphone, I'm sorry, what'd you say?
Any auxiliary water system that is on the property will need to have a backflow prevention device.
Oh, so what? So that nullifies what I asked, right?
It means if you have a well.
Well, let me ask you a question. If you have city water and you have a well for your irrigation, you still have to have it for your well for the irrigation, even if the irrigation water does not go in the house. That's not what the DEP told me, so I'm misinformed.
Yeah.
Sorry.
I believe that's correct.
Okay.
Oh,
let me make sure.
How much is it expected to cost?
As was reported last week, up to $1,000.
I got the figure, $750.
For each person that has a sprinkler system?
$750, and then you've got to get inspected every 2 years.
Wait, I don't like this.
Who does?
I don't like this at all.
It's goofy. It's not us.
Hold on, Walter.
This makes about as much sense as a box of rocks.
Hold on, Mr. Henry. Hold on.
You're still talking.
Yeah. All right. Anybody? Any other questions for this lady? Thank you.
It's called a backflow, right?
Check that out. Let's make sure on that with the wells.
Yeah.
Okay? Please.
Come on, Mr. Henry.
Mr. Henry, come on. It's my birthday, and I want to go ahead.
Matter of fact, since you mentioned that, I think you and Jenna both have
Jenna's
the same.
Too,
Jenna's
so.
Birthday too. Yeah, right. So. Happy birthday, both. Of
I'm glad that we can spend it with you.
Thank you. Happy birthday. I'm more excited than he is for some reason.
Walter P. Henry, 614 Maple Avenue, Panama City, Florida. Happy birthday.
Thanks, Ms. Henry.
Yes. The backflow preventer. Anybody can say whatever they want to say. Backflow preventer do not. All y'all, it's not. City not get anything from anybody putting in a backflow preventer. The person that sells it. Backflow preventer is there. It's there to water. They keep the customer water. If anything happened on the customer side. Keep it coming into this, going back into the city's line. That's what a backflow preventer is for.
Right.
I understand.
Now, I don't see no need of putting one on a well. It's supposed
but
to
they're
a well.
Making us.
They just pulling it. They putting the water
right
back
sense.
In the well.
It doesn't make sense. You're right.
Right back down the pump with back in the ground where it coming right back again. Then the next thing I say, y'all saying, y'all asking us to do this. What are you going to do about your meters that you have? Are you going to put back for revenues on them? Y'all not taking care of us, but y'all looking for us to take care of you.
You're talking about DEP or us?
In the city, what are you buying from the county?
Because we're being mandated.
We have to do this on our city properties. We have to do it. Yeah, just like...
On those meters that you got for the county that's serving the city, y'all ain't putting micro revenues on them. Y'all putting terminated water into our house.
We have to, too.
But we can't. But we're not able to put it back to you. But you can put it back to us.
Okay. Anyone else? You guys have a great week. Thank you for being here tonight.
We need to.